Now, if I was one of those people, I would never buy that deodorant, ever.
Yeah.
But the idea of being stressed, you know, truthfully, today we're going to talk about this idea. This week we're talking about physical health. Last week, if you missed it, we talked about spiritual health. If you didn't get to hear it, I'd encourage you to get online. If you're watching online, make sure you don't miss last week's message. This is our second week in 50 Days of Transformation. And here's what I know. I want to do a quick survey. How many of you would like to be healthier? Okay. If anybody did raise their hand, just look at them and say. Okay, how many of you would like to live longer if you could? Okay. Yeah, I don't know anybody who's not that. So here's the thing that I know about you and about me, is there are two things we already know about that have to do with health. And I'm not going to talk about them today specifically. They're in, if you're doing your 50 Days of Transformation, they'll be in your devotions this week. It talks a little bit about diet and about exercise. But most people that I know, I don't have to say, is exercise good for you? I've never had anybody go, nope. And I've never had anybody say, yes, bacon and waffles 6 days a week are great for you, okay? I mean, they're great, just not great for you, okay? And so we know about health that way. But what I'm going to specifically talk about today is the part of your health that really, in America especially, makes more of a difference than anything for you. And it has to do also with your relationship with God, and can you trust God? Because the truth is, when we fall into this, and one of the reasons we fall into this is because we're not listening to God, we're not spending time with God, and we're not really trusting Him in all these areas of our lives. And so we're going to look at one of these main passages. Last week we got to look at the story of the prodigal son, which really we talked about should be the story called the loving father. And this week we're going to look at Psalms 23, one of the most famous psalms. We're going to break it down and give you seven ways that you can deal with stress. So, first of all, Proverbs 14:30 says this: peace of mind makes the body healthy. And then in Proverbs 14:30, it also says in a different version, a relaxed attitude lengthens a man's life. It's the idea of being relaxed. All of us know that when we're stressed out, it's not good for us. How many of you have ever gotten stressed to the point that you felt like your chest hurt? Anybody ever get there? Right? I've been there. One of our speakers actually talked about the idea that he had what they used to call a nervous breakdown, just due to stress, due to all the things he was doing. And you know, just, it doesn't matter where you're at sometimes when you allow these things to get to you. So here's the seven things we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about worry. We're going to talk about your work today. We're going to talk about your problems, indecision. We're going to talk about loss, whether it's grief or some other type of loss. And we're going to talk about opposition. We all deal with opposition, people who are against us. And then we're finally going to talk about fear. And we're going to give you seven spiritual habits from Psalms 23 that reduce stress. Now, I got to go to one of the best conferences in the country. One of the guys who spoke was the guy who designed the software for Macintosh. And he worked for Apple for years, and then he worked for, I think, Adidas, and he's worked for a couple other big companies. The guy was brilliant, gave an incredible talk. I got to hear some of the best pastors and teachers in the country. One of the ladies actually started a group that deals with human trafficking, and one of the places they're in is Greece. It's the first place they started. They stepped out in faith and went there first, and now they are actually able to convert the containers that they were shipping girls in, those big containers, they were shipping girls through Greece in those storage containers, and they've converted them now to places for the refugees who are flocking to Greece now to take showers and to get water and to wash their hands, and those very containers that Satan used for evil, God's using for good.
Amen.
And I got to hear different pastors, Andy Stanley, who's an incredible pastor, different pastors from all over the country shared, and secular leaders, one lady who had studied emotions and why we react the way we do to people. She works, I believe, for IBM now. And why we react to people the way we do, and how we have to learn to deal with our emotions. All of that was awesome. But let me tell you my biggest lesson from the conference. I was sitting during worship, and they had some of the best worship in the country. By the way, worship's great this morning. You know what's awesome? To stand back there, and all the people who are back there mixing, and they're busy, and they're working, they were all singing and worshiping today and lifting up their voices. You know, I went to this conference, I didn't know any of the songs. I did not know a song. And for me to not know a song is really, because I listen to Christian music just about all the time, and I sat there and went, I just hummed along, and I said, you know, I'm going to practice what I tell you guys to do. I'm going to sing, even though I have no idea what I'm singing. And I did, and the people next to me didn't walk away, so I guess it was okay. And that wasn't real loud, I'll admit that. But by the end of the week, you know, by the end of those 4 days, I actually learned some of the songs. I didn't learn all of them, I'll be honest with you. I was still kind of going, oh, they're not starting here. Okay, here we go, you know. But while we were worshiping, I kind of sat in the bleachers. And what happened is the seats were here, and then there were seats facing this way towards the stage. The stage was here, so it kind of sat this way. And there was a girl sitting here, lady. She's probably about 30. And it was obvious that she had an arm that was deformed. I don't know whether it was a disease, whether she had broken it. I don't know. But every time during worship, that whole day that I sat in that one spot, when she began to worship, she'd raise that broken, deformed arm to the Lord. And as I sat there, I thought, you know, Lord, that's really all of us. We don't have it together. We're all broken. We're all mad. We all have our preferences. Did you know you have things you like that I don't like? And did you know you might be wrong? And guess what? I might be wrong, and that's okay. But God isn't worried about all the stuff we worry about. When we lift our broken, messed up, imperfect lives to Him and we say, God, I'm yours, He uses us. And as we go through Psalms 23 today, David was going through difficulty and going through a hard time. And he was saying to God, God, I'm yours, and here's what you can do. It's a psalm of faith. And so we're going to go through it one step at a time, and I'm going to give you seven just practical things. I'll have to move through some of them pretty quickly, but I'm going to give you seven really practical things, and I want to encourage you to get a hold of these things, maybe underline a few of them. You might want to just mark it for later or say, I want to go look that up. And I hope that it'll really encourage you and inspire you today to really trust God no matter what's going on in your life, and to not make the minors the majors and not dwell on the things that don't really matter. Number one, I want to look to God to meet my needs. See, stress comes in our lives when we look to other people or other things to meet our needs. And do you know how we know when we're looking to anybody but God? We worry. When we don't seek God to meet our needs, the first symptom is worry. What are you worried about? What's bothering you? Right now, whatever you're worried about, you're trusting in something other than God. In Psalms 23, verse 1, you all know it. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all I need. Maybe you learned it. I will not want. It's the idea that I have all that I need. We need to quit expecting others to meet our needs. Don't expect your spouse to meet your needs. Don't expect your boss to meet your needs. Don't expect that neighbor to meet your needs. Don't expect that TV show to meet your needs. Don't expect food to meet your needs. You know, all these things we put our trust in, we need to say, you know what, God, you're the only one who can meet my needs. When I feel lonely, it's not food that'll meet my need. When I'm hurting, it's not that person that'll meet my need. It's not if I'm not single anymore, then I'll be... Listen, if you're needy and single, you'll be needy and married. There's been studies done that over, I think it's 2/3 of people that are married are lonely. So don't think just because you marry somebody, that's going to meet all your needs. Trust me, if you do not lean on God, you won't be a good partner either. In Romans 8:32, Jesus said this, or Paul said this about Jesus. God did not spare his own son, but gave him for us all. So with Jesus, God will surely give us all things. Do you want your stress to drop dramatically? Begin to get a hold of who you are in Christ. One of the reasons that we're so hard on our children sometimes, one of the reasons that Christians are known for being legalistic and mean and grumpy and all those things we know Christians at, is because they haven't recognized that it's not them trying to earn themselves their way to God. If you're a Christian, the difference between your faith and everyone else in the world's faith is that we believe what God did for us, not what we can do for Him. All my life, I've heard this story in Matthew 13, the pearl of great price. If you've never heard it, I'm going to read it real quick. It's two verses. Again, Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who when he'd found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it." Can I tell you something? All my life, I believed and I had been taught that this story was about me selling everything to get to God. If you really love God, you're going to give up everything and you're going to serve Him. And on the way to the conference, I was thinking about this passage and I was thinking about what my sermon was about last week. I know, I actually remembered my own sermon. It was an amazing thing. And I began to think, wait a second, that's in that same place. And then I began to realize the pearl of great price is not us seeking God. The pearl of great price is what God did for you. You're the pearl of great price. God said, "I loved you so much, I sold everything. I gave everything. I gave Jesus' life for you." You are the pearl. It's not you trying to earn your way to God and be good enough or have it together enough. Listen, the only reason you and I can come to God has to do with mercy and His grace. And when you and I get a hold of that, and we quit trying to please God, and we quit trying to please everybody else, and we quit trying to find our satisfaction everybody else, guess what? You're going to be a lot less stressed out. You need to go through God's Word. And I know everybody focuses on this idea that we're sinners saved by grace. And we focus on the sinner part. But here's the truth. When you're a sinner saved by grace, here's what happens. The Bible says you and I have been made righteous. Not because you did anything. Not because you have it together. You are still broken, but God restores you. And He loves you. And when you and I get a hold of that, our stress dramatically increases. If nobody else is happy with you, God's happy with you. If you're not happy with yourself when you look in the mirror, God still loves you just as much. And when you and I begin to receive that love, we begin to feel accepted and loved, even if nobody else seems to love us or care about us, even if we don't love ourselves. And what begins to happen is you begin to love you because you realize that God loves you. And it leads you to worship. If you have a hard time worshiping, it could be because you think worship is about you pleasing God. It's the fact that God is pleased with you. When you give your life to Jesus, He says, "I accept you just like you are. I love you. I forgive you." When we do that, we begin to worship. I want to encourage you to take this week, take some time and take the alphabet and take some time to praise God using the alphabet. And you can thank God for things. You know, "Lord, I thank you for apples. Lord, I thank you for boats." And I want to encourage you, spend some time worshiping God, because when you do that, you realize all that God's done around you, and you begin to realize, "God, you love me. God, I don't feel like you should love me. I don't feel like I deserve your love." And let me tell you the truth, you don't deserve God's love. But He loves you anyway. In your brokenness, your messed up, failure, everything. Number two. We need to obey God about rest. Some of you are stressed because you never rest. You're a go, go, go gadget. Right? You just keep going. A lot of stress is from us overworking because we're insecure. We're trying to prove something either to ourselves or somebody else or somebody who died years ago. Something we have in our head. By the way, I struggle with this. I know that's a shocker. My family knows this. I've always struggled with this. Why? Because I grew up in a home where my dad owned a construction company, and we worked for my dad, and my dad was constantly going, "If you do this, you're a good kid, and if you don't, you're not a good kid." So I grew up thinking, if you work hard, you're good, and if you don't, you're lazy. And he really thought all pastors were lazy. So my brother and I all both struggle with this, although we talk about our schedules and think we should do something else. And that insecurity, that voice that we hear, can cause us to do all kind of things. So make sure you're not just pushing yourself and forcing yourself to do things because somehow you think you're going to measure up. We have to receive God's acceptance. Listen, do you realize God did not have to make us so we would rest? You ready for this? This is going to freak you out for just a second. You're going to spend one third of your life on earth sleeping. I know, you heard the mattress commercials. They remind you of that, right? God didn't have to make us that way. He could have made it where we could go 24 hours a day. He could have made us like machines, but he didn't. He created us to need rest. In Psalms 23:2, it says, he makes me lie down. It says, makes me. I remember when Kyle was little, and I'd put him in the bassinet next to the bed and pull the bassinet over, and I can still remember the sound because it would put me to sleep. I would pat his little diaper. It's hard to believe that now, as he's 6'1", right? But I remember patting his diaper. I was so tired, and just patting his diaper and thinking, go to sleep. Please go to sleep. I need sleep. The Bible says he makes us lie down. In Exodus 34, he even put it in the Ten Commandments. 6 days are set aside for work, but every seventh day you must rest completely, even during your season of plowing and harvest. You must observe a Sabbath day of rest. Do you ever take time to rest? My rest day is Monday. Now, rest day for me, I like to work in the yard. I know some of you hate to work in the yard, but for me, I enjoy it. It's one of the few things that I get to complete. So I planted a few plants. We've got a great guy who mows the grass. I don't even have to mow grass anymore. It's awesome. But I like to plant plants, and I like to go and trim the hedges a little bit sometimes. And I like, you know, there's other things. I like to fertilize the yard. I like to make sure, you know, there's little things I like to do. So for me, that's rest. For you, that might be a burden. Look for things where you, on your Sabbath, you can rest your body, where you can refocus your spirit, take time to worship, and where you can recharge your emotions. Let me tell you something. If you don't take time off, your body will make you take time off. If you don't take time off, your body one day is going to go, you're taking time off. Yeah. Number three, I love this one. Recharge my soul with beauty. He makes me lie down in lush green meadows and leads me beside calm, quiet waters. He restores my soul. Did you know God could have made the earth like the moon? You ever wonder why God made nature so awesome and so beautiful? It was for His glory and for your enjoyment. He didn't have to do that. I never forget sitting with my kids at Prince Edward Island and looking out over the ocean and saying to them, you know, we should enjoy this at home. And then I've taken them out to the water here and I've said, do you realize that there are people? By the way, right here, you are 10 minutes from beautiful scenery on the water. Did you know that? Or less, maybe 5. And I've sat on the water with my kids, sat over by the bridge in the big city of Titusville, right? And I said, do you realize there are people who drive all over the country and even from out of the country who will come and sit on the water here and go, wow. I bet you these people just love being here. And we get our blinders on and we forget where we live. Hey, take some time to go sit. I have a huge, wonderful advantage because 3 days a week I study on Wednesday morning, I study on Friday morning, and I study on Saturday. 3 days a week I get to sit on my back porch and study. I get to watch squirrels frolic and play. I get to see lizards run across the thing, and you know, I get to hear a neighbor yell at their dogs. I mean, it's exciting times, right? But I get to sit in the beauty of nature, and I want to encourage you. Even if you just need to put a picture on your wall in your cubicle. I mean, if you don't have a printer, you bring me a picture, and I'll print it on our printer and say, go put this, pin this to your wall. To think of God's beauty. In Philippians, it says it this way, you'll do best by filling your minds and meditating on things that are true, noble, reputable, authentic, compelling, gracious. The best, not the worst. The beautiful, not the ugly. I love that in the Message version. You know, in the NIV it says whatever things are true, whatever things are lovely. But here's the deal. Because of sin, there's a lot of unpleasantness in the real world. And so there are things that we give our attention to that actually raise our blood pressure. Did you know that? My brother-in-law, one of my brother-in-laws, I have two, so you can't guess which one of their dads went to the doctor and had really high blood pressure. And the doctor said, tell me about your day. And the dad went through how he basically watches the news all day long. And here's what the doctor said. I want you to try turning off the news, turn on anything else, HGTV, go outside, whatever, blah, blah. His blood pressure, after a few weeks, went back to normal. If you wake up in the morning, hey, instead of instantly turning on the news or getting on your Facebook or tweeting or Instagramming or, you know, getting the latest reports or having your alarm go off with some, how about instead we have a worship song on our phone? Something to remind us what matters. You know what song comes on my phone? Now, it's not a Christian song, but you know what song comes on my phone? I Love the Simple Life. Do you know that song? I love the simple life. It's just talking about how life is complicated and we need to take time to relax, take time to breathe. And I would encourage you, take time to meditate on God's word. Take a few minutes. Hey, do you know what? If you don't watch the news for the first half hour in the morning, if you don't watch the news all day, did you know what? The world will keep spinning. But we think somehow if we don't watch it, everything's going to go wrong. So think of things. What would raise your stress? And what would lower your stress? Spend time in God's word. Spend time praising God. Steve DeWitt says this: beauty was created by God for the purpose to give us the experience of wonder. By the way, we lose wonder. When you're a little kid, everything you see, you go, oh, one of the reasons I love to spend time with Lydia. Lydia's 20. Lydia hasn't lost her wonder. I take Lydia to Disney World and she sees a princess and she goes, oh, oh. And I go, what? I take Lydia to McDonald's and she says, Dad, let's go park on the water. So we get a hamburger and we go park on the water and she watches the fish jump. And I tend to go, I'm in a hurry, I got things, right? Wonder in turn is intended to lead us to the ultimate human expression and privilege, worship. Beauty is a gift and a map. It's a gift to be enjoyed and a map to be followed back to the source of beauty with praise and thanksgiving. Listen, some of you run, and I know you're trying to get from one place to the other. Some of you have a long commute. I know you have to get from one place to the other. Can I encourage you, even while you're in the middle of busyness, to look around? I mean, keep your eyes on the road, but look around. Start your day with God. Get outside. Maybe take up an instrument. Maybe you've never played guitar. I'll give you a lesson. I'm a horrible guitarist. You don't want to learn from me, but I'll teach you. Number four, go to God for guidance. Sometimes we're stressed out because we have to make a decision and we can't. We don't know what to do. We're at a fork in the road, like Yogi Berra says. We just take it, right? Yogi Berra used to say, when you get to the fork in the road, take it. And we don't know what we're supposed to do. In Psalms 23, it says, He guides me in right paths. Why? For His name's sake. Don't make others your main source for direction. Don't even make the list the same source. Can I tell you, when we started this church, can I tell you, if I looked on paper, I would have never started this church? Can I tell you, if I just leaned on myself, we would have never started Surfside? And yet over 80 folks have gotten baptized and taken that next step of faith. Last week, 4 people took that step of faith in baptism. And today, 2 or more will take that step of faith. We're going to be out at the beach at 1 o'clock and say, I want to get baptized. I want to take that next step of faith. And yet, sometimes we make a list and we go, oh, well, it didn't come out the right way. I'm not supposed to do it. Listen, you pray and you ask God, God, you give me your desires. You give me your desires. If any of you lacks wisdom, James says, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it'll be given to you. Number 5, trust God in the valleys. I'm going to do this one quick, but this one's big. I just don't have time to talk about it. Grief is not a bad thing. We grieve over loss. Some of you have lost a spouse through death. Some of you through divorce. Some of you maybe lost a parent or some other loved one in your life. Grief is good. But fear is not good. And if you're not careful, grief can lead to fear because it paralyzes you. You worry about the future and you don't go forward because you're concerned about the future. Listen, the Bible, over 365 times, the Bible says, fear not. It never says, grieve not. Never. It's okay to grieve. Don't tell people it's not okay to grieve. But when your grief turns to fear, that's when you have to begin to go, you know what, God, I know you want me to continue going forward, even though I have this great loss. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear some evil. Even though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Because you're with me. Your rod and staff, they comfort me. The good news about the valley is the only light in the valley is when you look up. So when you find yourself in a valley and there's darkness all around you, I want to encourage you, look up. Look up. I know we all get to the point that we want to quit. We all get to the point that we want to stop. But seek God. In Psalms 142, it says, when I'm ready to give up, he knows what I should do. Number six, this is huge. Let God be my defender. One of the hardest things for me to do when somebody questions me is to not want to defend myself instantly. God has to teach you this. You do not have to correct everybody about you. And listen, when you do defend yourself, and there's times that you need to do it, make sure you're not just doing it about you. You can do that very selfishly and very self-centered. There's a time where somebody might ask you a question about something. It's okay to say what's right, but be careful that you don't think you have to go and tell everybody what's right and what's wrong. Let me tell you something. You'll start to look like a crazy person if that's all you do. In Psalms 23, it says this, you prepare a table before me, verse 5, in the presence of my enemies, and you anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Do you know who was anointed with oil? Kings. Oil had two main purposes. It did healing, and it also was a way of exalting somebody, saying, you're worthy. David says, you anoint my head with oil, which means you heal my mind. When I'm worried about what people say about me, you're going to prepare a table. Even while my enemies want to attack me, you're going to take care of me. Even while my enemies want to say that what I'm doing is wrong, you're going to take care of me. Even when my enemies make up all kind of stories and lies and you've had people attack you, God says, I'm going to feed you and show other people that I take care of you. Not only that, I'm going to anoint you with oil so people will say, wow, that person's anointed. Now, they may not use the word anointed. They may say, gosh, they just have joy. They seem to have peace. Gosh, God's just blessing them, even in the middle of difficulty. He prepares a table and he anoints your head with oil. Your cup overflows. That's talking about joy. How I love you, Lord. You're my defender, my protector, my strong fortress. In you I'm safe. You protect me like a shield. Last thing today. This is huge. This is the biggest point of the day. So you have to wake up for this one, okay? Expect God to finish what he starts in me. This, I believe, is the most common, and it's a thread throughout all the other six. Do you fear the future? Can you trust God, or are you a what-if person? What if this? What if that? Are you a but person? God says, I want you to do this. But God, you don't know. But God, what if this happens? But God, what if this happens? Listen. In Numbers chapter 13, you remember they sent 12 spies into the land. And what God told them to do is check out the land. God didn't tell them to come back and say what they couldn't do. God said, go check out the land. They brought back grapes that were so big that they had to carry them on a pole between two people. And they hung to the ground. They brought back all this fruit, right? 10 of the spies, they started to give a report. Oh, there's this wonderful fruit. It has milk and honey, and there's plenty of food for everybody. It's an awesome place. And then the 10 spies started saying, yeah, but you don't understand. We look like grasshoppers. But you don't understand, blah, blah, blah. But you don't understand, blah, blah, blah. And they started to make up the buts. And let me tell you something. There were 12 spies. Shamua, Shiphat, Igal, Palti, Gadil, Gadai, Amiel, Sethur, Nabi, and Guel. Anybody name any of their kids any of those 10 spies? Anybody in here know, heard those names? No. There's two other spies that gave a positive report. You know what their names are? Joshua and Caleb. How many of you know somebody named Joshua or somebody named Caleb? What happens when you listen to a bad report is more than just now. It's also the future. It impacts not only your future, but even other people's future. Be careful. Listen, you have a choice. You can live in the promised land, or you can live in butt land. You can live in the promised land, or you can live in butt land. Some of you are living in butt land. But God, you don't understand. But God, this. But God, but what if? But what if this happens? Listen, every year that we make a church budget, I hate that part of the year. Because every year, you know what happens? I get attacked by buttland. And I have a tendency to walk over to Buntland and go, but what if? What if the economy goes down? What if people don't give? What if this doesn't happen? What if we don't have the money for this? What if I don't get paid? What, you know, what am I going to do about my kids? But what? And I find myself in Buntland. And can I tell you something about Buntland? It's depressing. It's discouraging. It doesn't push us forward. It doesn't make us look ahead. And I guarantee you there are churches now today that are living in Buntland. And Buntland's no fun. I've worked at some Buntland churches. But what if? I can't even know. I remember one church I worked at. We bought t-shirts for the youth. We spent about $100 and bought like 50 shirts. And it was unbelievable the deal we got. And I had people come and attack me for buying t-shirts. But what if the youth ministry doesn't grow? But what if we don't have the budget? But what if this? And I remember thinking, hey, just watch. And we grew the youth ministry from about 30 kids to about 100 kids. And I remember thinking, there are always going to be Buntland people. And if you're not careful, you'll end up in Buntland when you listen to the Buntland people. I want all of you to go to the promised land in your life. I want you to see what God can do in your future. I want you to see what God can make happen in your future. I don't want you to listen to the people that are stuck in Buntland. I want you to move forward and say, God, I'm going to the promised land. You're going to take care of me. And God, if I end up getting fired, then you know what you're going to do with me next. And God, if I can't afford food this week, you know you're going to provide for me. And God, if this happens, then you're going to take care of me like you always do. He will finish what he starts in you. Get out of Buntland and get to the promised land. There you go. Yeah. Bet you never heard a pastor use butt that much. He says, surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The worst thing that can happen to you is the best thing that can happen to you. The worst thing that can happen to you as a Christian is you die, and the best life now starts then. It doesn't start now. The best life now starts then. Because you're going to the promised land if you're a Christian. If you've given your life to Jesus Christ, you're going to a better place with everything where there are no more tears, no more hurting, no more suffering. He has prepared a place. But let me tell you something. He wants to use you on this earth, but if you continue to make excuses, he will not be able to use you. If Jesus couldn't do a miracle in a town where they didn't have faith, he can't do a miracle in a church that doesn't have faith, and he can't do a miracle in a home where you don't have faith. So I want to encourage you, God, I'm going to trust you even when I don't understand. Jesus said it this way, Matthew 11, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. When I'm yoked with Christ, we move together in the same direction and at the same speed. Listen, you can trust him. He loves you. The yoke that Jesus gives you is not the yoke of the Pharisees. The yoke of the Pharisees was the law and trying to please God and trying to measure up. The yoke that Jesus gives you is, come with me, I'm yoked with you. So when I go fast, we're going to go fast. When I slow down, we're going to go down. The speed will always be just right when you trust Jesus. You won't have to live in stress because you'll know that he's going to take care of you every step of the way. You'll take time to enjoy the beauty along the way. I want to encourage you. Some of you today, all you need to do is to go sit on the water and just over and over say, God, I trust you. God, I'm going to trust you. God, I'm going to trust you. And begin to say, God, help me to quit walking in excuses and help me to walk in faith. He wants to give you rest. Are you tired of running? Are you tired of doing your own thing? Then begin to say, God, give me the rest that only you can give. And that's one thing he'll do. If you're here today and you're not a Christian, the first way that you can get his rest is by saying, I want to give my life to God. I'm tired of trying to live for myself, and I surrender my life to you. If you're a Christian and you've been running on your own and making excuses for it, I want to encourage you, rest. And of all things, please don't be one of these people that gets stressed about being stressed. Just say to God, God, I don't even know how to go overcome this. That's a prayer God answers, by the way. God, I need your help. I know I live this way. I don't know what to do. Help me. And he'll help you. Psalms 23. Take time to pray that this week. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I pray that you would calm our hearts, that you would slow us down. Father, that we could be so still in our hearts, even when life is busy, that we could hear your still, small voice. Lord, I know even today there's folks here who've been so busy and life has been so hard that they have a hard time even listening. Lord, I pray today for just a moment that you would still their hearts. Lord, I pray for that one today that's having a hard time living in faith. They live with what if all the time. I want to pray, Father, you would give them the faith that only comes through your Spirit. Father, release us from the requirements of other people, from the requirements that we put on ourselves, and help us to recognize your love and your grace for us so that we can live blessed and not stressed. We trust you today, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to have our time of giving.